Please take a seat. Can one of the law review students maybe start to close the doors? I think there's another student who wants to get in. We can let them in. All right, Lewis, I think we're about to begin, okay? I just want to thank everyone for coming here and welcome you here to the West Virginia University College of Law. I'm Anne Marie LaFaso. I'm, as you know, the Associate Dean for Faculty Research and Development here at the College of Law. I'm also the Labor and Employment Law Professor. I'm going to introduce the lecture series, and then Dean Bowman will introduce our speaker. I first met Ed Baker in January 1989. I have no recollection of that initial meeting. He was my constitutional law professor at the University of Pennsylvania School of Law. Penn mandated that all 1Ls take that course in their second semester of their 1L year. The registrar then randomly divided students into two groups. One group got Baker, the other group got Seth Kramer. I got Baker. My first recollection of Ed was shortly after that. He was standing at the front of the classroom and said something like, and I'm going to do his accent, and I apologize for those who are from Kentucky. This is my Kentucky accent, or where he's from. You're going to receive your first semester grades today. Some of you are going to be happy. Many of you will not. I was a mediocre student at Yale, but I have gone on to do exactly what I wanted to do with my life. Ed and I became lifelong friends, his lifetime, not mine. After law school, I regularly kept in touch with him. He visited me in Vermont when I clerked for Judge Oaks. When I worked at a large Wall Street firm, he and I often met for dinner. When I decided to attend graduate school in England, he visited me 3 times and even gave a few talks at my institution. Then I moved to Washington, D.C., and he visited me there. And when I returned to New York to argue before the Second Circuit, I would meet him for drinks near the courthouse. We spoke often, usually once a week, sometimes only once a month. I always asked, "What are you writing about?" I eagerly listened to his summary of his latest article or book. Then one day, Ed died. His life was cut too short, complications from a childhood disease, diabetes. We are here today in this bittersweet tribute to Ed, because Ed, who had no children, decided to leave the bulk of his estate to charity. Nancy Baker, Ed's sister, agreed to my request to use some money to sponsor an annual talk in honor of Ed and of his favorite ideas, liberty, equality, and democracy. When the College of Law created this lecture series in Ed's honor, we also devoted space in our law library to Ed's papers. West Virginia University College of Law would like to thank the Baker family for its generous donation. The family could not be here today, but have asked me to give their regards. Before I turn the stage over to our esteemed dean, I'd like to tell a very short story. My co-clerk, Ann Reed, was a graduate of Bolt Hall at Berkeley. I was telling a story to my other co-clerk, Michael, a Yale law grad, about my con law professor, Ed Baker. Michael had never heard of Ed, so I chastised him for not knowing the greatest First Amendment scholar in the country. Anne overheard this conversation and protested that her con law professor, Robert Post, was the greatest First Amendment scholar in the country. Later that night, I called Ed to ask him about this Robert Post person, and Ed said, "Robert is one of the best First Amendment scholars in the country. Not as good as I am, but quite good." With that, I'd like to turn this over to our dean, Greg Bowman.
Thank you, Dean LaFaso, and welcome. Thank you to all of you for attending today's lecture. The C. Edwin Baker Lecture for Liberty and Equality and Democracy is truly an important event at the WVU College of Law each year. So I'm very pleased and proud to introduce our speaker for this year's Baker Lecture, who is at least the second best First Amendment scholar that we know of. Robert Post is the Dean and Saul and Lillian Goldman Professor of Law at Yale Law School. He holds his bachelor's degree from Harvard University and his law degree from Yale Law School. He received his PhD in the history of American civilization from Harvard University. After law school, he served as a law clerk for Chief Judge David Bazelon in the U.S. Court of Appeals for the D.C. Circuit. And for those of you who may not know, Judge Bazelon is a true giant in American jurisprudence. Dean Post then served as a law clerk for Associate Justice William Brennan, Jr. on the U.S. Supreme Court, another giant in American jurisprudence. So now here he is, a giant in his own right, to deliver the Baker Lecture today. Dean Post's areas of expertise, as Dean LaFosso has said, include constitutional law, First Amendment, legal history, and equal protection. He is author and editor of numerous books, including Citizens Divided, A Constitutional Theory of Campaign Finance Reform. That's such a great title, Citizens Divided. Published by Harvard University Press in 2014. Some of his other books include Democracy, Expertise, Academic Freedom, A First Amendment Jurisprudence for the Modern State, and For the Common Good, Principles of American Academic Freedom, and Constitutional Domains, Democracy, Community Management. In addition, he has written numerous book chapters and law review articles, including articles that have appeared in the California Law Review, the Texas Law Review, and the Virginia Law Review. And his work has been published and translated abroad, including in German and Chinese. But his most important piece of work, however, is yet to come. An article tentatively entitled Compelled Commercial Speech, which is slated for publication later this academic year in the West Virginia Law Review. We may only be the fourth oldest law review in the nation after Penn, Harvard, and Yale, but with this coup, with Dean Post as one of our authors, we are now clearly the first best. Or maybe the second best after the Yale Law Journal. Dean Post will be speaking today on that topic, the topic of compelled commercial speech. So we are very pleased, Dean, to have you here today, and we look forward to your remarks. Thank you.
Thank you both for that warm welcome, and it's a pleasure to be here at the fourth oldest law journal in the country. That's fabulous. So, and it's also a special, it's very meaningful for me to be given the opportunity to deliver this fourth annual Edward Baker lecture. I would say that I counted Ed as a very good friend and a precious colleague. I always sought out his views, and I treasured his advice. His work on the First Amendment, and in my view, especially on the media, is of really the first rank. Its range, its prescience, its integrity exemplify to me the very best of American legal scholarship always had. And I mourn Ed Baker's untimely demise, and I personally miss his intellectual companionship. So it's a great feeling for me to be able to give this lecture, and I thank you for the opportunity to do that. Ed was most famous for his claim that First Amendment rights express human autonomy. We have the right to speak, he said, because each of us need to express and define ourselves, and we do that through language. And Ed said the First Amendment, therefore, First Amendment rights should have no application to those arenas of life in which we did not express our individual human autonomy. And so he is famous for reaching the conclusion that what we now label commercial speech, which is a burgeoning area of First Amendment jurisprudence, should have no First Amendment protection at all. Ed argued, and here I'm quoting him, commercial speech reflects market forces that require enterprises to be profit-oriented, and therefore commercial speech could not be, quoting him, a manifestation of individual freedom or choice. And Ed, I would say, with some degree of confidence, would have been appalled at recent Supreme Court decisions which have struck down perfectly ordinary commercial regulations on the ground that they violated the rights of commercial speech. In Ed's view, a post-Lochner world, and a post-Lochner, just to say a few words about what that means. Lochner is the famous substantive due process case that struck down a law giving maximum hours for bakers in the early 20th century. And that case has come to stand for freedom of contract, substantive due process, and the whole New Deal revolution in American constitutional jurisprudence is the rejection of Lochner. So Lochner is what we call the anti-canon. It is what we reject, and courts now say the state should have a relatively free hand in administrative regulations of the market, but courts should be active in protecting what roughly we would call human rights, that's Caroline Products. So in Ed's view, a post-Lochner world, and he's writing this in the 1970s, so it's a post-Lochner world, was one in which, quote, constitutionally protected liberty does not normally encompass a right to be free of constraints in market transactions. So he was drawing the deduction that by rejecting freedom of contract, you're rejecting the notion of autonomy in the commercial marketplace. And yet, in the context of commercial speech, the Supreme Court, under the leadership, say, in this context of Tony Kennedy, has said very provocatively, it has said, although the Constitution does not enact Mr. Herbert Spencer's social statics, which is a passage that he's quoting from Holmes's dissent in Lochner, it nevertheless does enact the First Amendment. So this is calling into question, are we really in a post-Lochner world? And commercial speech has been an arena for that struggle. And Ed would have been particularly appalled at the burgeoning area of something I am now going to call compelled commercial speech. These are basically mandated disclosures in the context of the marketplace. And the courts have been very active in subjecting these to rather stringent review in striking them down. And Ed would have been, I would say, appalled by these decisions because typically when you prevent the state from compelling someone to talk, you do it on the grounds of their autonomy. So not only are you not autonomous in the area of commercial speech, but compelled commercial speech doesn't give you any autonomy. And Ed would have been, Ed would have been staggering in disbelief at these decisions because they so misplace the value of autonomy. So in Ed's honor and in his memory, I thought I would use the occasion of this Baker lecture to discuss this. This metastasizing doctrine of compelled commercial speech. And in this talk, I'm going to particularly focus on recent decisions of the District of Columbia Circuit, since that circuit has been very active in deciding cases in this area. And as we go through these circuit court opinions, we shall encounter, I'm going to warn you now, so fasten your seatbelts, we're going to encounter a great deal of confusion and misunderstanding, which no doubt Ed Baker would have yearned to clarify. And so we miss him all the more as we look at these cases. So I'm going to begin the discussion by focusing on a very recent decision of the DC Circuits decided April 14th, 2014. The case is entitled National Association of Manufacturers, I'll call it NAM or NAM, versus SEC. And this is a case about a rule promulgated by the SEC pursuant to the Dodd-Frank Act. And what this rule basically said is those companies that use conflict minerals in their products have to do a due diligence report. And they have to report, they have to file a report on their website and with the SEC about any of the minerals in their products, with conflict minerals, which they find to be, quote unquote, not found to be DRC conflict free. So conflict minerals are minerals like gold, tantalum, tin, and tungsten. They're typically mined in the DRC, the Democratic Republic of Congo. Typically, the mining of these minerals has led financial resources that has fueled a vicious, horrific civil war in the area of the Congo. And the general public opinion is the only way we can stop the horrors, the massacres of the civil war is to dry up the financial sources of the civil war, which means no one should be buying conflict minerals, minerals whose purchase yields money to the, defined by the SEC, minerals whose purchase yields funds to the participants in the DRC civil wars. And so if you're going to use these minerals, you should use them in a way that's conflict-free, meaning recycled or mined and refined in some place other than the region of the Congo and its adjoining countries. So that was the nature of this rule. It comes before the D.C. Circuit. The NAM, NAM, the National Association of Manufacturers, attacks it as compelled speech. You're compelling us to file a report. Therefore, they say it should be subject to elevated scrutiny because compelled speech is bad under the First Amendment. That was the argument. A divided panel of the D.C. Circuit, 2-1, agrees with this argument, and it holds that the Commission's final rule violates the First Amendment to the extent that the statute and the rule require regulated entities to report to the Commission and to state on their website that any of their products have, quote, not been found to be DRC conflict free. That was the precise holding of the D.C. Circuit. And the D.C. Circuit reached this holding by saying the normal rule for First Amendment law is elevated scrutiny. There are certain narrow exceptions to that rule. This doesn't fit with any of the exceptions. Therefore, we give it elevated scrutiny. And once you have elevated scrutiny, the rule falls. So the court, I mean, the sentence I want to look at, it says, rational basis review is the exception, not the rule in First Amendment cases. So the logic of the D.C. Circuit is you have a First Amendment rule. That First Amendment rule is elevated scrutiny whenever you compel someone to talk. There are certain narrow exceptions. This doesn't fall into the exception. Therefore, we're going to strike this down. Now, I want to say that that picture of the First Amendment, you have a general First Amendment rule against compelled speech, is totally wrong. It's a complete mismatch with actually what we do in this country. Let me just give you two quick little examples. You go to the doctor, and the doctor fails to give you the proper advice, doesn't tell you, actually, you know, you've got cancer, you should go to the surgeon, or something like that, just doesn't talk. And you later sue for malpractice for having failed to talk, right? So in other words, it's a compelled speech. The doctor is under a legal rule to give you the advice that would be appropriate under medical malpractice, fails to do that. So this is a compelled speech issue. The doctor says, well, you can't compel me to talk. First Amendment says I get to say or not say what I want. That is not a defense to a malpractice suit. In point of fact, there's no First Amendment issue whatever in malpractice for what a doctor says or doesn't say. There's just simply First Amendment has nothing to do with medical malpractice. Or you can take this out of the context of a doctor's office. Just take a product, like you're buying a product, and there's a failure to warn in the product manual. A failure to warn, meaning a compelled speech, and you sue the product, the product manufacturer for failure to warn under standard tort, and you win, and the product manufacturer, say the manufacturer of a tractor or a car, or a microwave oven, fail to warn you, don't turn it on because it'll explode, whatever it is. And they say, oh, First Amendment defense. I don't have to be compelled to talk. Elevated scrutiny? No. There's no First Amendment defense for product liability, for failure to warn, or for warning inadequately, or for anything like that, right? That's just not the way we think about the First Amendment. To know what rules apply to the issue of compelled speech, we have to know what speech we are talking about, in what context, and what constitutional values are at stake in that speech. So we're talking about compelled commercial speech. The whole idea of commercial speech received no First Amendment protection whatever until 1976 in a case called Virginia Pharmacy. And at that point, the court said, actually, we're going to extend some protections to this thing called commercial speech. Roughly speaking, it's a more complicated than that, but roughly speaking, commercial speech has to do with the marketing of goods. So advertising for goods, sales pricing, the speech that surrounds commercial transactions in the marketplace. Just think about that as commercial speech. And the court developed a commercial speech doctrine on the explicit premise, quoting the court now, that commercial speech enjoys a limited measure of protection commensurate with its subordinate position in the scale of First Amendment values and is subject to modes of regulation that might be impermissible in the realm of non-commercial expression. Right? So from the very beginning, the court was aware that commercial speech and its regulation is different than regulating what it called non-commercial. Actually, it doesn't mean non-commercial. It means something else, which we'll talk about in a minute. But the normal First Amendment rules are not going to apply to commercial speech, which is a subordinate. Why is it subordinate? It's subordinate because commercial speech serves a particular constitutional value, and it gets the doctrinal protections necessary for the speech to realize that value. What is the value, constitutionally speaking, for the First Amendment? What is the value of commercial speech? The court was clear, crystal clear, from the beginning. It said that, I'm quoting it now, commercial speech is constitutionally protected not so much because it pertains to the seller's business as because it furthers the societal interest in the free flow of commercial information. So we protect commercial speech because we want to protect the flow of information. As the court said later in Central Hudson, which is the canonical, the most important commercial speech case of the last 3 or 4 decades, the court says the First Amendment's concern for commercial speech is based on the informational function of advertising, end quote. So when you see doctrinal protections applied to commercial speech, it's so as to serve that function, the informational function. Now, we should contrast that with what you are undoubtedly taught are the ordinary protections of speech, which do not turn on an informational function. They turn on something else entirely. Ordinary First Amendment doctrine, I'm putting ordinary in quotes here because it doesn't apply to all speech. It applies to certain speech where these values are going to be pertinent. We'll have to figure out what they are. But ordinary First Amendment protections say, the central point is the speaker gets to speak as the speaker wants to speak. This is what Ed Baker was talking about when he was seeing autonomy as such a central value of the First Amendment. The First Amendment is typically understood to hold you can't put words in a speaker's mouth. They get to choose their medium. They get to choose how they want to express. You can't have viewpoint or content discrimination. They get to determine the terms of their own communication. That's what the typical First Amendment doctrine is designed to protect. So it's designed to protect the autonomy of a speaker, not an informational function. In fact, in point of fact, typical First Amendment protections apply even, take the recent Alvarez case, even if what you're saying is deliberately false, doesn't matter, contradicts the informational function, doesn't matter. We're protecting the speaker's autonomy to speak as the speaker wants to speak. That's typical. Why is that? So I'm going to give you a theory of why that Ed Baker's theory was autonomy is an ethical imperative that applies to human beings wherever they happen to be. Therefore, the First Amendment gives you that autonomy. I don't think that works because of just take the simple case I gave you of the doctor. The doctor may have strong autonomy reasons to say, I believe in this version of medicine versus that. That doesn't suffice to trigger First Amendment coverage. There's no First Amendment question. We only actually make things First Amendment questions under certain specific conditions. And what are those conditions? We are speaking in ways that try to shape the content of public opinion. The key word in First Amendment jurisprudence is public. What is triggering First Amendment coverage in First Amendment context is always tied to public opinion, public discourse, a public figure, public official, of public concern. This notion of the public tends to be what triggers First Amendment protections for speech. Why is that? Well, roughly speaking, since the beginning of First Amendment jurisprudence, the court has always said, we protect freedom of speech so that we can have our democracy, so that we can govern ourselves. The court has time and again said the First Amendment is the guardian of our democracy, meaning the guardian of our ability to govern ourselves. What does the First Amendment have to do with self-government? Well, the answer looks something roughly like this. If you vote in an election and you lose the election, in what sense are you governing yourself? If I keep losing in elections, if I'm a Democrat in West Virginia, how am I governing myself if you're on the losing side? So it can't be that you're governing yourself only through voting. In the United States, you are understood to govern yourself by continuously participating in the formation of public opinion. And the First Amendment protects your ability to participate in the formation of public opinion, and the state is understood to be responsive to public opinion. So you participate in public opinion, state is responsive to public opinion. By transitivity, the state's responsive to you. You're living in a democratic society where you're participating in your own self-governance. Hence, the First Amendment is viewed as the guardian of democracy. Now, if in point of fact, as Madison once said, in every free state, public opinion is the final sovereign. Right? Those who participate in the formation of public opinion ought to have the privileges of sovereignty, insofar as you're participating, meaning self-determination, meaning autonomy. So the law ascribes the autonomy that was characteristic of First Amendment rights when you participate in the formation of public opinion. Call the set of communicative acts we deem as necessary for the formation of public opinion, just call that public discourse. So I'm just going to be using those words to refer to that kind of speaking. When you do that, First Amendment rights give you the privileges of self-determination, of sovereignty, meaning you're autonomous. And the whole idea is the state should be responsive to me. I get to say what the state should be responsive to, what I think or don't think, with my intensity, with my words, with my eloquence, with my passion. Because I want to experience the democratic legitimation of making public opinion responsive to me and what I think. Now, if that's the central core of the First Amendment, we can begin to understand the function of commercial speech protections. What the court has said there is we protect commercial speech for an informational function, meaning commercial speech distributes information to people who are participating as sovereigns in the formation of public opinion. If I need to know whether to regulate the price of coal or whether there's climate change and I should have the regulation of greenhouse gases, I need the information which commercial speech may give me. So insofar as commercial speech distributes accurate information that could be relevant to my deciding what I want public opinion to say, we're going to protect it. That's the way the court put together the thought of commercial speech and the central purpose of the First Amendment. Now, if once we see that, we can see that there are really two important differences between the doctrine, First Amendment doctrine, that should apply to commercial speech and the doctrine that should apply to public discourse. Not just two, but I want to stress two. The first is when the state regulates commercial speech, it's regulating it to preserve the informative function, and therefore there will be content discrimination. We have whole elaborate regulatory agencies like the FTC that regulate misleading commercial speech. We don't do that for public discourse. You can't regulate Barack Obama for being misleading. That's inappropriate. We don't do it, but we do content discrimination of that nature for commercial speech. And so the court was, from the very beginning, quite explicit about that. It said, I'm quoting it now, the First Amendment's concern for commercial speech is based on the informational function of advertising. Consequently, there can be no constitutional objection to the suppression of commercial messages that do not accurately inform the public about lawful activity. Right? It follows directly from the constitutional function, informational function, that we regulate it to make sure that it serves that function, that is, distributing information which is accurate. As the court says, the First Amendment does not prohibit the state from ensuring that the stream of commercial information flows cleanly as well as freely. We do not say that about public discourse because the object of public discourse is not information. The object of public discourse is for me to say whatever I damn well want to say to make public opinion responsive to me. And I can have wacko opinions, I could be misleading, I could be anything, and the state is not going to come and suppress me for that reason, because the point is a political one of self-governance, not an informational one like it is for commercial speech. Second point has to do with compelled speech, which brings us really to our topic for today. In public discourse, the state cannot compel you to speak. And you will see in some of the passages I'm about to read from court opinions, there's a lot of references to the case of Barnett. You might know Barnett versus West Virginia School District, which is the state of West Virginia trying to make a school child salute the flag. So participate in public discourse, say what you're loyal to, what values you have. State cannot do that. Why not? Because the point about public discourse is to make public opinion responsive to me. It's not to extract from me allegiance to somebody else's ideas. And so the autonomy of the speaker is really important in public discourse, and it means standard First Amendment doctrine that the restriction on public discourse and the compulsion to participate in public discourse are equally bad. There's a symmetry between compulsions to speech and restrictions on speech, which follows from the fact that the essential point is for me to maintain my own subjective authenticity when I speak, period. I'm the only judge of that. Now, contrast that to commercial speech. In commercial speech, the function is to distribute, circulate information. If I am forced to speak by distributing information, I serve that function. I don't contradict it. So compelled commercial speech actually advances the underlying constitutional value at stake. It doesn't contradict it, as it does in the context of public discourse. So in the context of commercial speech, restrictions on speech and compulsions to speech are entirely asymmetrical because of the underlying constitutional value at stake, which is why we protect commercial speech at all. Now, the court early on was very aware of this difference, and in an important decision, which we'll be talking a lot about, a decision called Zouderer versus Office of Disciplinary Counsel, the court reviewed restrictions by the state of Ohio on attorney advertising and compulsions that that attorneys had to put in their ads certain things. So when it reviewed the restrictions, the court adopted an elevated test. It's called the Central Hudson test. We will talk about it in a few minutes. But when it came to talk about the compulsions to put certain things in those ads, it said, we're dealing with an entirely different problem here. So I'll read you what it said. The court says, appellant overlooks material differences between disclosure requirements and outright prohibitions on speech. In requiring attorneys who advertise their willingness to represent clients on a contingency fee basis to state that their client may have to bear certain expenses, even if he loses, Ohio has not attempted to prevent attorneys from conveying information to the public. It has only required them to provide somewhat more information than they might otherwise be inclined to present. We have, to be sure, held in some instances compulsions to speak may be as violative of the First Amendment as prohibitions on speech, but the interests at stake in this case are not of the same order as those discussed in, and then it cites some public discourse cases, including Barnett versus West Virginia. Ohio has not attempted to prescribe what shall be orthodox in politics, nationalism, religion, or other matters of opinion. The state has attempted only to prescribe what shall be orthodox in commercial advertising, and its prescription has taken the form of a requirement that appellate include in his advertising purely factual and uncontroversial information about the terms under which his services will be available. Right? So basically it says the complainant, the attorney's First Amendment interest in not being forced to disclose more information are only minimal because autonomy interests are not at stake in commercial speech. And it concludes this way. It says, we do not suggest that disclosure requirements do not implicate the advertiser's First Amendment rights at all. We recognize that unjustified or unduly burdensome disclosure requirements might offend the First Amendment by chilling protected commercial speech, but we hold that an advertiser's rights are adequately protected as long as disclosure requirements are reasonably related to the state's interest in preventing deception of consumers. That's a very important sentence. And what happens if we go now back to the National Association of Manufacturers, this is the conflict minerals case, it reads that sentence very narrowly. So Zouderer is arguing disclosure requirements and restrictions on speech are asymmetrical. Disclosure requirements, since they serve the constitutional value of distributing information, should need be only reasonably related to the state's interest. It happened to include the state's interest in that case, which was misleading consumers. But the D.C. Circuit in the National Association of Manufacturers says, no, the general rule, it says, remember that sentence I read you, the general rule, says NAM, is that you can't compel people to speak. You only get this rationally related, therefore, when there's a narrow exception. We read Zouderer narrowly to say the only time you can compel commercial speech is if you want to stop consumers from being misled. Any other purpose? And you can't compel the commercial speech. You have to have the more elevated scrutiny, Central Hudson, which we'll talk about in a minute. Right? So that was the logic of NAM, that these exceptions to compelled speech have to be narrow. And that is what I've just argued to you, is a complete misconception of how the First Amendment works, how the First Amendment applies in the area of commercial speech, and the relationship between compulsions of commercial speech and prohibitions on commercial speech, which are asymmetrical, and therefore should not be subject to the kind of logic that NAM has. NAM has in its mind the image of an autonomous commercial speaker who can't be compelled to speak because there is an autonomy interest. if you're going to think about that autonomy interest in the context of the commercial marketplace, you are right back to Lochner. You are right back to the notion of freedom of contract, because everything you do in the marketplace is through communication and speech. And that is precisely what the Supreme Court took such pains to avoid when it created the underlying doctrinal structure of commercial speech. It did not want to go back to Lochner. It wanted to say, we are creating rights here, but rights in listeners, not rights in speakers. Right to information flow, not autonomy rights of democratic legitimation in the marketplace. And so that tension is what NAM is overlooking. It's not being sensitive to it. And you can tell the problem with NAM itself. So in the rule that the SEC promulgated, corporations have to file long, complicated reports about where they mine their conflict minerals, who refined the minerals, who got the money for the minerals, et cetera. The D.C. Circuit doesn't strike down the need for the report. It strikes it down only insofar as you have to use the phrase not found to be DRC conflict-free. That's bizarre if what you care about is the autonomy of the speaker. You care about these reports, not about this particular phrase. So the contradiction of trying to import these autonomy rights into the commercial marketplace manifest in this NAM decision, just plainly manifest. So let me say a word about the central Hudson test, which is the test that you would use if you were to use the elevated scrutiny that NAM wants. Central Hudson test gives the generic test for restrictions on commercial speech. Mainly, now here the value is the interruption of the circulation of information. So the constitutional value is the circulation of information. And Hudson says this. It says, in commercial speech cases, a four-part analysis has developed. At the outset, we must determine whether the expression is protected by the First Amendment. For commercial speech to come within the provision, it at least must concern lawful activity and not be misleading. So right at the outset, you're dealing with content discrimination. Next, this is the second prong. Next, we ask whether the asserted governmental interest is substantial. If both inquiries yield positive answers, we must determine whether the regulation directly advances the governmental interest asserted and whether it is not more extensive than is necessary to serve these issues. So you get a four-prong test. The last three prongs, is the government interest substantial? Does it directly advance it? Is it narrowly tailored, roughly speaking? Now, the issue is, if you're going to look at protecting flows of information, none of these prongs are particularly connected to the flow of information. And so no one really knows how narrowly tailored it has to be, what an interest must be to be substantial, what it means to directly. None of this is clear. There are vast uncertainties about the application of the central Hudson test, which basically functions as a Rorschach test. So some courts apply it very stringently and strike down everything. Other courts apply it very loosely, and they permit a lot of restrictions on commercial speech. The test is abstract. It doesn't really connect to the underlying constitutional value. But roughly speaking, courts understand central Hudson to apply intermediate scrutiny. Whereas Zouderer, the case I just read to you, which just applies a reasonably related test, is understood to apply something closer to a rational basis or a highly deferential test to the regulation of commercial speech. And there's important issues at stake about which level of scrutiny we applied to compelled commercial speech. And let me roughly set out the stakes for you in this. I would say, in the years since 1970, in the United States, when we think about administrative regulation of the marketplace, there has been a general unease with command and control forms of administrative regulation. And that most people have verged toward, if you want to regulate the marketplace, do it by enforcing information disclosures. Because information disclosures respects the autonomy of consumers better, it respects the autonomy of producers better, it allows for more market efficiency than command and control. So there has been a general move in the larger realm of administrative strategy away from command and control and more toward disclosure as a strategy. Now, you put that side by side with the central Hudson test, and the central Hudson test would put at risk this whole move of administrative law. It would put you back into a command and control form of regulation, and it would say because the First Amendment is involved in these disclosures and therefore it's subject to these uncertain provisions of the central Hudson test, it'd be safer for an administrative agency just to do command and control regulation. That'd be a very bad thing. And we do these forms of information disclosure for many reasons, apart from protecting consumers from misleading or false speech. Just to give you three simple examples that I'll come back to, the Truth in Lending Act, right? The credit market was a mess. Consumers got different credit offers described in different ways. The Truth in Lending Act says, look, well, you're going to all describe your loans in one way, and so consumers can compare the loans. What it does, you all know that a market is efficient when you reduce information costs. The Truth in Lending Act reduces information costs, increases consumer welfare, makes a better, more efficient market in credit, and it doesn't have to do with misleading. It has to do with making the market function better as a market. So if you want to see another better example of that, just look at the requirements of disclosure that the SEC imposes on publicly traded corporations. Massive disclosure requirements on publicly traded corporations. It doesn't do that to prevent stock buyers from being misled. It does it to create a transparent market, a market that about which one can have confidence, and that will be stable. Right? And this is the explicit goals of the SEC. That would be put at risk by the kind of judgment that the National Association of Manufacturers talks about. Or let me give you one final example, the Nutrition Label and Education Act. You know, when you go out and buy something at your store here, like, and you want to see what the sodium content is or how many calories, you get a label. That's all government-required disclosure. Right? And the function there isn't to prevent you from being misled, like you somehow knew that the Mounds candy bar had low, you know, you think it has low calories. No. It's so that you can make healthy decisions, right? If you need low sodium, you can see how much sodium you're actually taking in. And the function is to enable healthier food purchases by consumers. Standard, very successful. And yet, we don't have the empirical studies. If a court wanted to apply the final prong of Central Hudson, we don't know that you could justify it. The way the courts have applied Central Hudson, that act could go down the tubes. So it was a very important moment in this doctrine of compelled commercial speech when on July 29th of this year, that's only 3 months after the National Association of Manufacturers, the D.C. Circuit on bank overruled NAM. And it held, and it was in a case called American Meat Institute, AMI, I'll call it, versus Department of Agriculture. This case involves compelled labeling of meat products, where the meat was slaughtered and processed has to be on meat products. And it upheld the regulation, and it said Zouderer applies to governmental interest apart from simply preventing products from being misleading or false. The court holds, quote, the language with which Zouderer justified its approach sweeps far more broadly than the interest in remedying deception. Zouderer's characterization of the speaker's interest in opposing forced disclosure of information as minimal seems inherently applicable beyond the problem of deception. So that was a really important holding on bank. Now, other circuits may go the way of NAM, but this is very important that the D.C. Circuit on bank this summer actually sees that Zouderer's rationale does not turn on a particular state interest. It turns rather on the logic of commercial speech and compulsion and the distribution of information. But this D.C. Circuit opinion is so confused that it goes on to say, actually, if we think very hard about Zouderer, we can see that in the context of compelled commercial speech, Zouderer is simply an application of the Central Hudson test. It goes on to say that. Now, I don't have the time, but if I could, I could take you through that logic step by step and show you it's complete nonsense. It just doesn't make any sense at all. It patently misreads Central Hudson, and it's very hard to know why a court which takes a case on bank to decide when Zouderer, as opposed to Central Hudson, should apply and decides it should be for interests other than misleading, should then go ahead and write an opinion that conflates Central Hudson and Zouderer in such important and inexplicable ways. So I think the best reading of why it did that was for this reason. Zouderer says that the compelled disclosure has to be rationally related to the state interest, but it doesn't say which state interests. And underlying the D.C. Circuit opinion, and I would say underlying many of the cases that you see in this area, there is a concern about when and for what reason the government can compel commercial speakers to disclose information. That this is something that the judges want to think about. Zouderer doesn't give them any grounds to do that. But the second prong of Central Hudson, that would be for a substantial state interest, does give them a ground to say, well, you can only compel it for appropriate reasons, and so gives you some handle on when and how, when and for what reason the government is doing that. The American Meat Institute, AMI, was facing a very troubling claim in this regard. So the state Department of Agriculture had required labeling a point of origin and processing for meat products, but when asked to explain why, it was very silent. So it did not say it was necessary for health, because it said we wouldn't allow importation of any meat that wasn't healthy. It didn't say it was necessary to prevent consumer deception. So exactly why are you requiring this labeling? And the Department of Agriculture was really kind of mute, almost tongue-tied on this point. And the plaintiffs, the American Meat Institute, pressed this home and said that they were requiring this labeling only to satisfy what they called mere consumer curiosity, idle curiosity, they called it. And that sounds bad, right, to require a label just for idle curiosity as opposed to curiosity. And the unbanked opinion seems to agree with that, that you can't compel the labeling merely for idle curiosity. And in fact, AMI itself is very obscure about why the labeling in that case serves a substantial state interest. They say this. They say, here we think several aspects of the government's interest in country of origin labeling for food combine to make the interest substantial. One, the context and long history of country of origin disclosures to enable consumers to choose American-made products. Two, the demonstrated consumer interest in extending country of origin labeling to food products. And three, the individual health concern market impacts that can arise in the event of a foodborne illness. So these three somehow together make a substantial, well, this is a very odd and dispirited list. I mean, I don't understand how you combine these disparate things first. Second, either the labeling to prevent foodborne illnesses. I mean, botulism attacks Argentine meat. I'm a consumer. I better know which of my meat is Argentinian. Either that's a substantial interest or it's not. I don't see how putting in a list adds it. This idea of the historical regulation, that's really a way of gesturing at what it was in fact at issue in the American Meat Institute case, which is buy American. Right? American government wants American consumers to buy American meat. They think they will buy American meat. And if you label it Canadian meat, they'll be less likely to buy it. But the DOJ couldn't say that in the litigation because these labeling requirements are under attack at the WTO as protective regulations. And so they were caught between a rock and a hard place. They couldn't say it to promote really American products because then they would be confessing error before the WTO. The third interest is the one I really want to talk about. So the court says another one of these in this list is consumers really want to know where their meat came from. Well, to say that they really want to know where it comes from, is that idle curiosity or is that justified curiosity? How are we going to make that distinction? And what do you mean by idle curiosity anyway? What exactly is that telling you as distinct from what? So I'm now going to give you a way of reading what the court was saying that might make sense of it, because what the court says surely doesn't make any sense. And I want to say this. I want to say, why do we disclose information? What's a good reason to disclose information? And I've given you some hints with the Truth in Lending Act and with the SEC. A good reason to disclose information is to reduce information costs and therefore to make a market more efficient. Right? If you make a market more efficient by disclosing information, you have increased consumer welfare. Now, consumer welfare could be cashed out as idle curiosity. On the other hand, it could be cashed out as welfare, which we normally do when we do commercial regulations. We say we want markets to be efficient. We say we want to maximize consumer welfare, meaning what they want, meaning their curiosity. Right? So I think a position that one should generalize out of this case is it is a substantial state interest, just like health, just like safety, for information disclosing provisions to be enacted in order to promote welfare. That's to say, make a market more efficient. That surely should be a substantial state interest. And I don't see any reason whatever why it shouldn't. In a very powerful concurrence, Justice Kavanaugh says on the D.C. Circuit, if you did that, you would allow, if you allowed mere curiosity to justify compelled disclosures, government could externalize onto the backs of producers the requirement to talk about anything and everything, and that would be dreadful. That would be just that would limitless. And the answer is, no, it wouldn't be limitless. If roughly the cost of ascertaining and distributing the information is less than the gains to consumers, that's not a limitless principle. That's a standard economic understanding of what increases welfare, what increases the efficiency of markets, and that's a perfectly applicable limited principle of welfare increasing. Now, to make that, the state would have to know when a market and information has failed. And why would it fail? And you could tell a just-so story that, well, if the consumers really wanted the information, somebody would give them the information, and therefore the government would never have the reason to require the information to be disclosed. And the answer to that is there are a lot of reasons why consumer markets and information fail. One reason is articulated by the Nobel laureate George Akerlof. You know his work on lemons. And why the market in used cars fails. If a consumer can't judge the quality of a product that they're giving, the market for that product is likely not to develop or likely to fail. And the same could be true about information. So I could be a producer. I could disclose information like pomegranate juice. But if the consumer doesn't actually believe it or can't verify it, then the market in that information is likely to fail and often will fail. And since information is, as you know, non-rivalrous and non-excludable good, there is no interest for a third party to develop that information in such a failed market. So that's one reason. Another reason is something that we see in the truth in lending context. Producers of products do give information, but they give it in a way that the average consumer can't use. So this bank gives this sort of disclosure about its loan, that bank gives this disclosure about its loan, and I, the consumer, can't compare apples and oranges. So the strategy of the Truth in Lending Act was to say we create an arbitrary figure, the APR. Have you all seen that APR in the box? It's just an arbitrary thing that the government developed, but it allows you to compare apples to apples. And that means that for relatively low cost, a consumer can compare the information given by two producers, and that can maximize the information, the efficiency of the credit market. So markets can fail because producers don't have incentives to produce information that are low cost for consumers to use. In fact, they may have incentives to go the opposite way. So you're just listening to what I'm telling you about my product and can't really compare to other projects. So there are many reasons that information markets fail. And when they do fail, making those markets more efficient ought to be a substantial interest. And I think that the underlying concern, therefore, with Central Hudson can be handled in the sense of saying at least we know that welfare is a substantial interest, health, safety, and so on. Now, there's something else that's going on underneath. There are two things that are going on, really, I think, underneath the confusion of the unbanked opinion of the D.C. Circuit. One is there's a repeated reference in many of the individual opinions, like Justice Kavanaugh's, to the autonomy of the commercial speaker. You see West Virginia versus Barnett cited again and again and again, even though it has nothing whatever to do with this case. So there is this lingering sense of autonomy, which is productive only of confusion. But there's a second issue which I think we need to think about, and I'm going to defer to the end of this lecture to address it head on, and that is there's a relationship between compelled commercial speech and the formation of public opinion which has constitutional issues and overtones. And I want to talk a little bit about that at the end of my speech, and it might be a way of getting out of some of the uncertainties that you see expressed in the on-bank opinion of the D.C. Circuit. But before I get there, I want to talk about three subsidiary tests about the application of Zouderer, which the D.C. Circuit promulgates and which is, in fact, very common among the circuits in different areas. So they say, first, a mandated disclosure, quote, must relate to the good or service offered by the regulated party, a link that in Zouderer itself was inherent in the facts as the disclosure mandate necessarily related to such goods and services. They say, second, a mandated disclosure must not be so burdensome that it essentially operates as a restriction on constitutionally protected speech. And they say, third, a mandated disclosure must contain only, quote, purely factual and uncontroversial information about the good or service offered. So the first of these things is, I think, a very interesting one. Normally, you're subject to a commercial regulation if you choose to enter the commercial marketplace where the regulation applies. You know, if there's regulation on housing, they don't apply to you unless you're buying or selling housing. But information is different. Right? Information is abstract, and it can be applied to anything. So I could pass a law saying milk cartons have to carry the stock market, which has nothing to do with milk cartons. And so this first regulation, I think, makes information regulations analogous to commercial regulations. You only incur the cost of distributing information if they're relevant to the commercial transaction you're engaged in. That makes a certain amount of sense. The second requirement also makes sense. Remember, the fundamental value in commercial speech is the circulation of information. If my disclosure requirements on you are so burdensome that they impair the circulation of information, then that's a problem. That should be subject to Central Hudson, not to Souter. But it's this last one that I want to spend a few moments thinking about because it raises very interesting philosophical problems, that the disclosure contain only uncontroversial and purely factual information. So first, purely factual information. What does that mean? Purely factual as opposed to what? And here, I think the contrast should be to opinion. There's a Supreme Court decision about a decade old now called United States versus United Foods, in which a mushroom manufacturer was forced to say something. It was forced to say, mushrooms are good despite no matter what the brand. So the mushroom manufacturer didn't actually believe that. It believed its mushrooms were better, but it was forced to issue an opinion like this. The court said, can't do that. So United Foods should be interpreted for the fact that when you have a mandated disclosure in the area of commercial speech, it must be of factual information, not of opinion. So why not? Well, there's a number of ways we can think about this. One is the informational function of commercial speech goes to information, not to opinion. Put that another way, I, as a listener, have a right to know your information, whether or not you want to give it to me, but I don't have a right to know your opinions, whether or not you want to give it to me. But why would that be true? So here's a way of analyzing that problem. If we think about, we protect commercial speech because it gives information to those who are participating in the formation of public opinion. So the premise of commercial speech doctrine is public opinion is better if it has more information than if it has less information. Information, facts, are unambiguously good. Better to have an informed opinion than an ignorant opinion. That's the premise of commercial speech doctrine. Is it true that public opinion is better if it has more opinions rather than less opinions in an analogous way? And the answer is no. And why is that? Because the function of public opinion is to make government responsive to what people actually want and think. And therefore, if the public opinion is a product of opinions that people don't actually believe or opinions that people don't want to actually say, it's not increasing, it's corrupting the function of linking government to what people actually want. So if you think about the structural relationship of opinion to public discourse, even in the commercial area, you can see that there's a very good reason to draw a distinction between opinion and fact. And it's actually quite interesting and difficult to do that. So let me come back now to the National Association of Manufacturers' opinion. Remember that it gave a general analysis which didn't make any sense given its narrow holding. The narrow holding was only you couldn't compel the corporations to say not found to be DRC conflict free. So why just that particular phrase? Well, one hypothesis might be the court understood that to be an opinion, the disclosure of an opinion, not a fact. So let me read you a passage from the DC Circuit. They say, it is far from clear that the description at issue, whether a product is conflict-free, is factual and not ideological. Products and minerals do not fight conflicts. The label conflict-free is a metaphor that conveys moral responsibility for the Congo War. It requires an issuer to tell consumers that its products are ethically tainted, even if they only indirect and finance armed groups. An issuer, including an issuer who condemns the atrocities of the Congo War in the strongest terms, may disagree with that assessment of its moral responsibility, and it may convey that message through silence. By compelling an issuer to confess blood on its hands, the statute interferes with that exercise of freedom of speech under the First Amendment. So now this logic is not the logic we talked about before. This logic is you can't compel issuance of opinion. So is the idea of DRC conflict-free an opinion or a fact? How do you know that? Well, if you look at the SEC definition of it, it's purely a fact. It says, did the purchase of this mineral contribute financial support to the warring groups in the Congo? That's a fact, whether or not. So in the literal terms in which the SEC is defining the phrase, it is obviously is a fact. This seems wrong. But NAM might have objected to the impact of that label not found to be conflict-free. So the panel may have believed if you say that, you're going to incur the condemnation of an audience. The condemnation of an audience is an opinion. So in fact, you are provoking opinions by giving them this fact. So let me just contrast that very quickly to another compelled disclosure case that was decided coincidentally just 2 months before NAM in January of 2014. This is a case out of the Fifth Circuit, and it concerned the registration requirements of the Sex Offender Registration and Notification Act. You know that act requires if you're a sex offender and you move to a new jurisdiction, you have to register, in other words, compelled speech, the fact of your conviction. And the court, the Fifth Circuit, says, well, that is a literal confession of a crime. It's not a metaphor for a crime the way the D.C. Circuit was worried about conflict-free. This is like, I committed a crime, and I have to register that with the jurisdiction. And the Fifth Circuit says, well, this disclosure requirement is perfectly okay because it requires the disclosures of facts rather than, quote, religious, political, or ideological belief. Right? And if you look at remedies, routine remedies by the NLRB or the FTC, they normally require wrongdoers to confess, I've been convicted of this crime, and therefore this is a remedial advertisement or something like that. So the Fifth Circuit, if you look at that opinion, it suggests that the D.C. Circuit, if it imagined this phrase to be an opinion, is mistaking a fact with the opinions that a fact or emotional reactions that a fact can arouse. Facts can arouse lots of opinions. It doesn't make them less factual. And it wouldn't bring this requirement under the rubric of United Foods. Here's another way to look at what might be going on in the D.C. Circuit opinion. This distinction between facts and opinion, is very well established in many First Amendment areas, including most particularly in the area of defamation. In defamation, you can be liable for a defamatory false fact, but not for a false opinion. And so opinions are quite sharply distinguished from facts in the area of defamation. And how do you do that? You do it by its effect on the audience, how an audience would understand a phrase. So famous case in the Supreme Court, a newspaper calls somebody who's negotiating with the city saying this person is committing blackmail. So the state, it might even be West Virginia, finds liability saying blackmail is a fact, it's a crime, and he didn't commit blackmail, therefore defamation. And the Supreme Court says no. Anybody looking at that word blackmail would understand they're not talking about a literal fact and a crime. They're talking about negotiating in an unduly harsh way, which is an opinion. And so they understand it to be an opinion and therefore privileged. So the National Association of Manufacturers case might have been saying, well, conflict-free is a similar, for the audience, they would understand that as a confession of moral guilt or taint, and I did wrong, rather than an actual fact. They could have been reasoning in that line. If they were reasoning in that line, then they made a mistake, because then they should have remanded it to a fact finder to say how would ordinary people understand this phrase, because it's certainly not obvious that it's the way the D.C. Circuit. But more fundamentally, the SEC never said to the corporations they had to define this phrase in a certain sort of way, and so the corporation filing this report were free to define it in terms of the statute and make very clear they're not morally responsible for this. They're just this is just the nature of the minerals. So I think even if you take this view of it, it was wrongly decided. But that doesn't mean that the boundary between fact and opinion isn't a difficult one. It's extremely difficult. We can look at another D.C. Circuit case, the J.R. Reynolds case. This is where the FDA required certain pictures to be on cigarette packs, like man without a trachea and secondhand smoke, and they put them on the cigarette packs. And the D.C. Circuit basically strikes this down. It strikes it down for one reason, that Zouderer doesn't apply, except if it's misleading, and this isn't about misleading. That's out of the question now in the D.C. Circuit. But the second reason is, when you show those pictures, you're really giving an opinion. This is a dirty product, don't buy it. And you can't compel the disclosure of opinions. So that's an interesting holding. And the idea of graphic disclosures do raise really difficult issues. Certain graphic disclosures to display information. So if I show you the sign for radioactivity or the sign for poison, you know what I'm telling you and you know the information. So graphic images is not inconsistent with just being information. But on the other hand, graphic images can also display opinions. So the Jewish Star and the Nazis, or the Scarlet Letter on Hester Prynne, these are graphic symbols that contain opinions of condemnation, degradation, exclusion, etc. And so which are these images on the cigarette pack? Who knows? But that's something that one would have to think about as one analyzed that case. The final thing I wanted to talk about in terms of that is, remember it said that the information must be uncontroversial. What could the court have meant by saying that the information be uncontroversial? What could that possibly mean? The people in AMI, the American Meat, found it very controversial that they had to disclose where the meat was. But it can't mean that the party doesn't want to disclose the information. That can't be the meaning of it. Nor can the meaning of it be that the information is being disclosed in the context of a live controversy. Because we may need information most in the context like obesity or nicotine, where there's social issues around it, but we need to know the facts. So I would say the best way to interpret this notion that the information be uncontroversial is that it referred to the epistemological status of the information. That is to say, if that information, the truth of that information, is seriously controverted, then by forcing a speaker to give that information, you're really forcing them to give an opinion about the truth or falsity of the information, and it could come under United Foods. That's the best meaning I can give to this idea that the information be uncontroversial. Okay, so where have we gone? What we have said is, look, if we look at these compelled commercial disclosures, they're absolutely essential to most modern and progressive forms of marketplace regulation, which concern information markets, which are information forcing. And this line of reasoning under the First Amendment not only makes no sense in practical terms, we don't want to go back to command and control regulations. We want to be able to have nudges and information flows do our work for us. But moreover, it makes no sense within the very doctrine of commercial speech, which the court created very carefully in 1976, to extinguish the idea that there is a constitutionally autonomous speaker in the middle of the commercial marketplace. And so it is really particularly disturbing to see in case after case after case, I've just talked about DC Circuit cases, but I could go through all the circuits, in case after case dealing with these compelled commercial speech issues, they are always citing cases like West Virginia versus Barnett. And they're always saying the autonomy of the speaker is being compromised, and that's always giving a constitutional flavor to their analysis of it. And that is a really dreadful thing, that the courts are so confused about the First Amendment values at stake in this question of compelled commercial speech. And I just want to pause for a minute at the end to draw back and look at this from 30,000 feet. Think of the most ordinary facts of commercial life. Think of what it would mean, for example, now to lease an apartment house, or to lease an apartment, or to lease a house. In any of these commercial real estate cases, there are disclosure requirements that the government requires. There's a federal statute you might know of, the consumer leasing statute, which requires the disclosures of lots of information for leases that exceed 4 months. And there are some state statutes. If you go look at Washington, the state of Washington, for example, it has a 6-page list, literally, of what you have to disclose before you can enter a commercial lease, including whether there's an outdoor sprinkler, whether the roof has leaked in the last 5 years, whether there are known defects in the hot tub or the sauna. It's the West Coast. And statute like these do not compel information merely to prevent consumer deception. They do it in order to make an orderly, efficient marketplace in the rental market. Now, this is compelled speech in its rawest and its most obvious form, and I would suggest that most literate members of the American legal profession would be surprised, if not shocked, at the thought that these compelled disclosures in any way raised a First Amendment issue, constitutional issue. These are accepted throughout the whole arena of commercial transactions. I have been unable to find even a single case that constitutionally challenges the CLA, the Consumer Leasing Act, in any way. And it comes, just pulling back 30,000 feet, it comes, and it should come, to you as something of a jolt to put these ordinary disclosure statutes against the high-minded constitutional principles of a decision like Barnett versus West Virginia, which celebrates the autonomy of speakers from the compelled avowal of government orthodoxy. I want to say to you, it requires truly a tin ear to confuse required participation in a flag salute with the compelled disclosure, just to give you some of the terms of the CLA, of the amount of other charges payable by a lessee not included in periodic payments. Both of these disclosures, it is true, happen through the medium of speech, but speech is serving entirely different constitutional functions in each of these cases. And to conflate these distinct functions, to imagine that the same elevated scrutiny as is required in the case of a compelled flag salute is necessary also in a commercial lease disclosure statute, that is really to be confused in some deep way. And the reason for that is this: to participate in public discourse, to take part in the formation of public opinion, is to exercise the sovereignty that democracy accords to each of us as a member of We the People. And sovereigns enjoy the principle of autonomy because they are, as sovereign, empowered to determine their own future. And our First Amendment jurisprudence properly awards this privilege to those who participate in the formation of public opinion, who speak in public discourse. But as Alexander Micklejone noted long ago, I'm quoting him now, in a democracy, the governors and the governed are not two distinct groups of persons. There is only one group, the self-governing people. Rulers and ruled are the same individuals. We, the people, are our own masters and our own subjects. So if a sovereign public opinion decides that the rental market needs regulation by disclosures, we produce anarchy rather than self-government if we do not accept our ability to rule ourselves and require these disclosures. When we participate in the commercial marketplace, therefore, we are, as individuals, not sovereign. We are collectively our own subjects. And it is not plausible to say that we retain the attributes of sovereignty insofar as we are speaking. That's because virtually all human action, including the commercial marketplace, occurs through the medium of communication and language. That's what it means to be human. Every real estate lease is a contract, and it exists through language and communication. If we were sovereign, therefore, whenever we were communicating, we could never govern ourselves at all. Contemporary courts that affirm that all compelled commercial speech is a compromise of basic speaker autonomy fail to distinguish between the speech of citizens who rule themselves, that is to say, public discourse, and the speech of citizens who are ruled, and that's commercial speech. The former requires special constitutional protections. The latter requires a listener set of rights because we say we have a constitutional interest only in the information that is distributed. Central Hudson and Zouder understood this perfectly clearly, but the modern courts have begun to lose track of that distinction, and that's a matter of very serious import. Now, I think underlying this concern, I want to detach two ways in which commercial speech influences public discourse. Remember, we protect commercial speech because it provides the information for public discourse. I want to suggest two ways that might happen. The first is it gives us more information. That's an unambiguous good. But the second is it frames issues. So in the Truth in Lending Act, the implicit frame is you ought to be a good consumer. In the Nutrition Labeling Act, you ought to care about your health. The difference in the Dodd-Frank Act about conflict minerals is that's not information disclosed in the process of a transaction, that's put on the web. And so it seems to be more about how public opinion should regard civil war in the Congo. That's a different way of influencing, framing, making salient issues in public opinion. Now, in a democracy, the government should be responsive to public opinion. It shouldn't make public opinion. That creates worries. And that might be underlying in some way what's going on in these cases. What I want to suggest to you is the court long ago crossed that bridge because the state, through its own government speech, influences public opinion all the time. So no one would raise an objection if the state of West Virginia, the Department of Agriculture, issued a report about obesity and said, watch what you eat. No one would raise an objection if the Department of State said, bad thing in the Congo, terrible, stop buying conflict minerals because it fuels these human rights violations and atrocities. No one would give it a second thought. And the court has now a very robust doctrine of government speech where the state can intervene to shape public opinion as it wishes. So compelled commercial speech has the same function. It does, in part, not only give information, it gives saliency and framing effects which affect public opinion, but no more and considerably less than government speech. Why? Because it's only uncontroversial information. So only insofar as that information has a salience effect. And second, we know why this information is being produced. There's nothing secretive or manipulative about it. And so if we think about the relationship between government speech and compelled commercial speech, we can see that even though there are something to be worried about, maybe that's why the courts care about why it is you're compelling the speech. That could be at the root of it. I don't know. Nevertheless, we can... We have some guidance. We know from the government speech cases when and how the government can intervene to shape public opinion. And we should use those cases as guidance when we think about when and how compelled commercial speech should be permitted. So I'll stop there. I've gone on too long. Thank you so much.
We will take a few questions before the students can go to a reception outside, and the faculty then will adjourn to lunch with our speaker. So that was, I think, a very thoughtful presentation, and I hope that has been thought-provoking for you. And so do we have some, if you do have a question, please come to the microphone. A surprise that John Taylor would like to ask a question.
Thank you so much for the talk. As I heard someone say, it's an all-meat sandwich, right? I'm just holding on, hope I got everything. Got a million questions, but how about this sort of 30,000-foot question? You started out with the idea that you and Ed would both think that this particular line of cases are sort of insane, right? You would say, if you go back to 76, the idea is we've got this distinction between protecting participation in public discourse because of a theory of democratic legitimacy, right? And then we've got sort of commercial speech subordinate to that. Ed's view, crudely expressed, would be speech protection is about autonomy. People have autonomy rights, and corporations do not, so this is crazy. Right? I mean, it's...
Well, he's saying the marketplace, you have no autonomy. So okay. This isn't about corporations
versus... Okay. Well, that sort of ties in. So my thought is, you know, what is the relationship between this and kind of a couple of ideological trends? I mean, we were talking last night, or I heard you mention that, you know, your wife had been writing about Hobby Lobby and so forth, and so between... And you've been writing about Citizens United. So we've got this sort of increasing trend toward basically, you know, corporations are people too, and if they're people too, then they have autonomy rights. You've got that dynamic coming in. You've also got the dynamic that if Ed's view is sort of, well, markets are not sort of the paradigmatic sphere of human autonomy, today I think a lot of people might react to that and kind of say, well, you know, no, that's kind of got it all wrong. It's in the market that we assert our freedom and who we are, and the freedom to do these things is what makes us who we are, and that is an autonomous domain. And I wonder whether sort of some shifting ideological currents around those ideas are part of what's creeping into and influencing these cases that you're talking about.
Yes, well, undoubtedly. That's what I was hinting at in the lock. Now, I had a long peroration about exactly this, which I cut because of the time. But I think that is, the First Amendment is designed to let everyone speak to determine whether we should be libertarian or whether we should be redistributive. But to read the libertarianism into the First Amendment is a mistake, because the whole point is it should be free to allow us to decide what we want to do and to speak the ways in which we want to speak. So what you're seeing is in the recent cases a decided trend toward the notion of autonomy in the commercial sphere. So Ed could never make this as a First Amendment argument. He'd have to make it as an a priori argument about why autonomy is inappropriate in the commercial sphere or doesn't really exist in the... Whereas I think it's easier to say, look, this is why the court protected it in the first place. And second, if you want to give that commercial autonomy, and then you can't have an FTC. You can't have an FDA. You can't have a lot of things which no one is willing to give up. That's why I'm pointing to the contradictions within the National Association of Manufacturer case, that they perfectly understand you can be forced to file a report. They don't want to say no SEC regulation of publicly regulated companies. They're not that crazy. But if they want to permit that, they can't, and at the same time give autonomy. So they're involved in an internal contradiction that makes for doctrinal incoherence. So I'm trying to give them a way to understand the thing in a coherent way rather than, you know, make a priori assumptions about where there's autonomy and where not.
Hi. You use two international law phrases, words, in your presentation, very importantly, self-determination and sovereignty. They started in international political philosophy and international law, not in American constitutional law. I have two questions. One, is the metaphor of sovereignty really accurate in the personal sense, in the way it originated in the international sense? In the international sense, the sovereign truly is independent, less so today than 100 years ago, but still much more so than the human being in even the most democratic of societies. And I'm wondering whether that metaphor overstates independence. Even in the French Declaration of the Rights of Man, sovereignty is not in the individual human being, but in human beings acting as the nation.
Correct.
So that cuts in one way. Cutting in the other way, though, I have another question. If one were to accept your metaphor, it would seem that it would be a good metaphorical argument to say, just as international organizations are merely products of states, whether it's NAFTA or NATO or whatever, and therefore they don't have the rights of states, they only have those rights that the states delegate to them. So too, companies, commercial entities, are only the products of your sovereign entities, people, and therefore to say that they have original rights rather than derivative rights is fallacious.
Okay, so on the self-determination, I could equally have used the word self-government, which comes right out of the American Revolution. Thomas Jefferson says, we fought a revolution to secure the blessings of self-government. So the idea of self-government, who is the self? So if I've taught, for example, freedom of speech at the Sorbonne, and you ask your French students who is the self and self-government, they'll give you the answer, the nation, the French nation, you know, the collectivity. In the United States, it's us. It's the individual people. We are individualist in a way that most European nations are not, most other nations are not. So we actually have a different idea of what that means, which is part of why we have a different First Amendment than or freedom of speech than most European nations. Now, when we're talking about commercial speech, I want to keep separate the idea of commercial entities from commercial speech. You could be your own, you know, you could be selling shoes in the marketplace, and it would be subject to the same doctrinal rules, even though you're dealing with a real person. So what's going on here is the form of speech, not the speaker. I just published this book, Citizens Divided, in which I talk about the rights of a speaker, which is an entity. And that is a whole different logic one would have to pursue. And that has to do with when it is that entities can assert the rights of members. And in the First Amendment, we have a doctrine called expressive association. There are expressive associations where people join together to express themselves more effectively. And those expressive associations are given full First Amendment rights as though they were individuals, whether or not they were incorporated. But other associations, like commercial associations, which are not expressive associations, are not given those rights as an individual. One of the mistakes in Citizens United is it sees no difference between the right of an individual for democratic legitimation and the right of a commercial corporation, which is not formed for that, and therefore must have First Amendment rights derived from its audience, listener rights on the model of commercial speech. And so its regulation would be the model I was setting forward for commercial speech, not the model of democratic legitimation, because it doesn't translate directly into the persons who can experience democratic legitimation, because by hypothesis it's not an expressive association. Too quick.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. And the students, there is some food for you out there. And the rest of us will go to the event center. Thank you.